little bit of electrochemistry and a little bit about CO2 utilization. So we like to work on doing things with the CO2 stuff, not the electrons in the batteries and other kinds of storage devices. So, yes. So, I'm from the Netherlands. We used to be one of the largest gas producers in the world. We have the largest onshore gas fields, but that's for the last 50 years. So we want to abandon the natural gas stuff and we want to switch to others. More renewable things. So the buzzwords are energy transition, electrification, and so forth. So our Dutch government have an ambitious goal. In 2050, we are not allowed any natural gas at all in industry, households, so forth. So that seems to be reasonable, achievable. That's only 30 years from now. But I mean, even our Royal Dutch Shell says that's not a realistic target. They aim at 2070. So we will see who has the say in the end. So, I mean, the argument of the Dutch government that electricity and renewables are abundant and cheap and that we can do better with renewables. So, but I mean, we don't have a lot of renewables. We have a little bit of solar. I mean, we are very north. We have a lot of wind, but we still have to build the wind parks. And the first estimates are about 60 euros, which is more or less the same as in dollars. It's 1.10 per megawatt hour. So, but this is just the production. So we do need the transmission and the distribution, all those aspects. So trivial things like transport, households. We are very popular with tech companies. We have a lot of data centers. And apparently, I learned the other day that the capacity of the data centers doubles every 5 years. So only 1% of the electricity production in the Netherlands is going to the data centers. So trivial things. We are very busy people. We have a large industry. We have big refineries, over a million barrels per day. We have a very strong chemical process industry. We are one of the largest agriculture exporters after the United States, second in the world. So, big challenge there. For your information, I live in Delft. Delft is about 20 kilometers off the shore, and maybe you're aware of that. 1/3 of the Netherlands is below sea level. So my sons looked this up for me. My garden is 1.5 meters below sea level. So we have dikes and dunes to practice against the water. But I mean, only one small hole in the dikes will be enough to flood a lot of the Netherlands. So from Amsterdam, The Hague, Rotterdam, all the major cities, they are below sea level. So, and of course, we have a nice competition. It's called natural gas. So, as I said, we know a little bit about natural gas. Yesterday we had Shell. They said there's enough for the next 170 years. I think that's even a little bit conservative. So I think there's 100 years of conventional natural gas, and you have stepping up here your unconventional shale gas production quite substantially. So about cheap and abundant, so it's indeed abundant, cheap. I looked up the Henry Hub price, which is for April, May, somewhere between 2.5 and $3 per million BTU. There are places where it's even almost free. If you go to Alberta, a little bit north here in Canada, Ras Laffan, one of the largest industrial sites in the world in Qatar, they produce twice the amount of natural gas that we used to produce per year nowadays. So there's huge amount of natural gas, LNG, gas to liquid sites. I think this is a very high number of $1.5 per million BTU. So if you convert that, 1 million BTU is about the gigajoule, so you get something like $5 to $10 per megawatt hour. So that's half a cent per kilowatt hour, and we are talking about $60 or maybe $100 per megawatt hour from the electricity. Okay? And then, of course, you need to look at some kind of forecast. So this is the forecast of our forecast. So the Energy Information Administration just here from the Department of Energy. So this is the projection for the United States, which seems to be one of the largest economies in the world. And petrol, nothing will happen in the next 30 years. Natural gas will go up, and a little bit of coal will be declined, or what is it, reduced. So in overall, this means for the next 30 years, more or less the same amount of CO2 emissions here in the United States. So my take on this is more renewables does not automatically mean less CO2 emissions. So we also have to look at how to deal with this aspect of fossil fuels. So Delft is a very is in the center of the Netherlands, and they are very engaged in the climate nowadays, like everybody else. So they are setting up a new climate institute. The first polls have come into the ground as to speak, but it's just an interdepartmental cooperation between different different departments in Delft. So one of the cornerstones will be the negative emission technologies. They would like to take those up. So from chemical engineering, process engineering, bioengineering, those kind of things. So we have I've developed a very simple approach based on what you see here, block flow diagrams, a little bit of flow sheeting, and then try to optimize some simple process to get the economics and the thermodynamic efficiencies for a bunch of processes. So one of the key things is is biomass. You can do a lot of things with biomass, thermal and biochemical conversion, pyrolysis, gasification. You can even put it in a digester to make biogas. Will provide some renewable CO2. And then, of course, you have a whole bunch of products you can make out of the biomass. So the key thing is, one of the key things is the CO2. We have reasonable, as I said, horticultural infrastructure where we use the CO2. We fed the CO2 to the greenhouses, and then it enhances the growth of, vegetables and fruits. We have the highest production of tomatoes per square centimeter in the world because of the horticultural industry. And you can go on. We can do electrification through hydrogen and make a lot of stuff by hydrogenation reactions. So today I will focus a little bit on two, three aspects. What we can do with biomass, how can we use that to generate some electric power, and think a little bit about what to do with all the CO2 that still is flowing around. So the key thing is, we learned that yesterday that biomass is a very efficient way of storing energy, hydrogen, those kind of things. So very simple, biomass is something with a C and H and O, so basically how our infrastructure, our economy is organized around carbon and hydrogen. So you store some energy and you can do a lot of process, as I showed you, but you still have to worry about the CO2. So as I said, interdepartmental, range of modeling tools, range of international and national projects. Most of the work we use the cycle tempo. It's a thermodynamic analysis of everything associated with power plants, fuel cells, different kinds of turbines, different kinds of processes, the compression, gasification, those kind of cycles. So, okay, so thinking about how to make this a circular economy, how to deal with the CO2. This is just a flow sheet. It's not a mass balance. It's not an energy balance because, I mean, thermodynamically, nothing, only a little bit of renewable energy goes in, but nothing comes out. But if you take, for example, manure, we have, as I said, large agriculture, a lot of livestock producing a lot of manure. So one of the issues with the Netherlands is it's too small to distribute all the manure and all the digest. We don't have enough agricultural land to distribute. So we export part of the digest state of the manure to Germany, which is much larger. But this is a little bit of thinking about manure. You have the biomass, you take a cow, you have the grass, it converts very efficiently into manure. You process the manure, you can do valorization of the manure, you get gaseous products, and an interesting option is, of course, to convert everything to biomethane, and then you can use the methane to operate your stables, your tractors, etc. Other things is the fertilizers. You have a lot of minerals that you like to recycle. So we have legislation which means that you cannot buy at the same time the nitrogen, the phosphate, and the potassium cycle. So very tricky business. And then, of course, you have a lot of water being moved around. Okay, so one of the things we are looking at is biomass, feeding that to solid oxide fuel cells. and do a few processes with that to convert the biomass into syngas, into electricity, and even some heat. So you have basically can operate it in two modes, the fuel cell mode and the electrolyzer mode. So in the fuel cell, it's basically you burn some fuel, you have some air to burn it to provide the oxygen, you have a solid electrolyte that's conducting the oxygen ions, and in the electrolyzer mode, you do the other way around. You have water and CO2 as the end product, and you try to convert that back to syngas. Okay, so it's not only modeling, we also test a lot of properties. So from the basic principles of electrochemical cells, the polarization curves, the current to potential distribution, a lot of testing stations, different pressures, different temperatures, integrated with cache cleaning, because after the biomass has been converted to a cache stream, there are a lot of impurities, different sizes for the fuel cells. So, summarizing, this is one of the first items, the energy system, so having biomass, gasifier, gas treatment, fuel cell and producing electricity. So you have different types of gasifiers, you have different types of gas treatment, you have different types of biomass, so there's a lot of work going on to understand what how the different processes take place. So this is the first example. So you can have, for example, the wet biomass, something like sludge or alky, and you can do supercritical water gasification to make it into a gaseous stream. The gaseous stream you can feed to the electrolyzer cell. You can operate it either in fuel cell mode or in electrolysis mode. So first option is electrolyzer mode. We can play with different options for the fuel cell mode. You have extra separation to remove some of the water. So these are typical compositions of the gas stream. So it's a standard syngas with a little bit of methane and a little bit of water, or maybe sometimes a little bit more than water. But I mean, you can play with that. So as I said, this quite traditional. You have even a lot of chemical reactions going on. So if you represent the biomass by something like a C6 molecule with the water, the steam, you can make the CO2 and the hydrogen. You can also directly convert it to methane and CO2. That's the supercritical water gasifier. In the fuel cell mode or in the electrolyzer mode, you can go both ways. So have either convert it to the water and the CO2, or convert it back to the syngas. As I said, we do a lot of testing and measuring. So this is an example of the typical efficiency. So here you have the energy efficiency as a function of the potential of the fuel cell. Playing with the different options, you can play with the lower heating value of the syngas. There's a reasonable efficiency, 72%, round trip efficiency of around 66%. A lot of options to optimize this. We have seen that the cooling and heating has a significant influence on the overall efficiencies. You can still further optimize the operating conditions of the fuel cell as well. Okay. So another example is the full chain, where we use, again, biomass gasification, cache cleaning, but we do some clever things in between. So we have some heat pipes for extra heat exchange and heat recovery. We can do some recycling of the combustible gases that has not been converted in the fuel cell. And in the end, you can even add an extra Rankine cycle to recover more of the heat that is from the flue gas. Okay, so As I said, it's not only modeling, it's also testing. So this is an example of a fuel cell that has been operated for about 150 hours at the stable potential and the stable efficiency. This is how it looks. We actually built stacks and those kind of things to test. This has been tested for example, different gasifiers throughout Europe, Austria, Germany, Denmark, and in Delft itself. So different gasifiers, different results, and stable operation for a significant amount of time. Again, looking at the efficiencies, so it depends a little bit on the scale. So typical efficiencies are, again, above 70%, so 72% for relatively small-scale systems. You can have a larger scale system where you have even a little bit higher efficiency. You can do the exergy. This is the efficiency as function of the pressure, so optimizing the conditions. We have all the details for all the different units, the different flows. Okay. So this is the last example for the biomass and the fuel cells. So you can have also solid biomass. You have a whole range of processes where you can convert the biomass. You need a whole bunch of cleaning steps, a number of different steps to remove all the impurities, not trivial, some kind of nasty molecules. You have particles. You can add different steps in between. You can have a reformer before you go to the fuel cell. You can do another things after the fuel cell to additionally burn more of the solid material. So a whole range of activities. So it has been developed, designed, manufactured, and optimized. We did sorbent and catalytic characterization of the different steps. An important aspect is the tar tolerance, so you have a small amount of particulates that will interfere with all the operations. And then we did a test run of the complete system with different kinds of wood chips and acro pellets. So let me slowly move now to the second item.
Two minutes.
So two slides, 2 minutes. Excellent. So the key thing is you have CO2 flowing around everywhere. I mean, people talk about air capture. Well, we have 10 gigatons running around from natural gas processing, power plants. So why don't we focus on what's more or less readily available instead of doing very sexy things with direct air capture? So there are not many options to convert CO2. I mean, it's the end of the process. You burn everything, and then in the end, you have CO2. So we are looking at three options: CO2 electrolysis, where you have CO2 solubilized in an aqueous phase. This is not a very sensible thing because CO2 has relatively low solubility in water, only 50 grams at 50 bars. That means that you have 950 grams of water flowing around. So the solid oxide electrocell seems to be an interesting option. And catalytic hydrogenation, so you have CO2, you take hydrogen, and you can make a few things out of that. So this, again, you need to think about all the interactions because it's always be more expensive than what we have now. So Europe has, for example, 17,000 biogas installations, a lot of CO2 available, small scale, but okay, it's doable. The first economic viable process have emerged. So let me move to the... last slide. So the question is basically, do we want to move CO2 around or do we want to move products around? Because, I mean, this is a more logistic problem. I mean, you have distributed units of CO2. We have, of course, point sources from steel to refineries. So in the end, the question is, what do you want to move around? But, I mean, looking at the scale, so basically in terms of products, there are only two products that seems to be interesting. Methanol, global scale, 65 million tons, and syngas to Fischer-Tropsch. Only in Qatar, they produce 170,000 barrels per day of Fischer-Tropsch liquids. So the first commercial process and demonstration process are emerging on Iceland or in Iceland, on Iceland. I mean, you have hydrogenation of CO2 from geothermal. It's a little bit more expensive than the market price, but it's green methanol. The first commercial small cells to convert you to CO, on-site generation if you need some CO. And in Denmark, they're very active in the biogas upgrading, so you have can electrolyzer cells, water, electricity, and you can convert, upgrade the methane to more methane, a little water. So this is the principle of can. You feed at one site, you can have an option to flush this. You can have high densities of currents. This is very high. Not too much potential. It can operate at 1.3 volts. So relatively efficient system to deal with your CO2. So let me wrap up, but you can read this. And otherwise, I'm running out of time here. But it's the trivial things. So we do a lot of things. So small scale, maybe that's good to remember. The CO2 market is a very small market. There's 30 million tons of EOR being here from natural gas, from natural CO2 sources at $10 per ton. We capture it from LNG, hydrogen production, at maybe $20 per ton of CO2, and then there's a little bit of industry activity. So that's my talk. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so any questions for Peter? Yes, please.
I have two questions. Solar natural fuel cell, you're operating at 250 bars. You can operate even at atmospheric pressure. Why do you need so much pressure? And the other one is your temperature is 500 to 700. It is not very efficient because of the resistance is more. That's why people try to go for 800,000 degrees Celsius.
So yeah, you're more or less right. But these are some typical examples we have been studying. It's not completely optimized yet. So. The pressure for the supercritical water gasification. So we do a number of different steps in series. So the pressure is for the supercritical water gasification. And the operating temperature of the fuel cells, that depends on the composition, as you mentioned. So it's being optimized. I mean, overall, we have efficiency between 40 and 70%. I mean, there's a catalytic activity in the fuel cell. You don't want to ruin that. You want to run this for weeks, not for a few minutes, which is one of the issues with all the electrochemical processes, that you have a very sensitive catalyst. It is sensitive to CO and you, whatever that will ruin the catalytic activity. So here you have the fuel cell, the material properties. You want to develop the technology, not to have a perfect catalyst in week one, basically. I hope that answers your question.
Okay. Thank you very much.